Hi everyone. In this video, I will provide some introduction to data mining and machine learning, especially how they can be used in research. In the age of the internet, social network, and cloud computing, we are overwhelmed with tremendous information and data that are being collected and shared in real time. The question is, what can we do with the data? Let me start with one of my favorite TV shows, Person of Interest. It's a CBS sci-fi thriller show that was aired from 2011 to 2016. The main character, the man with glasses, is Harold Finch, a math and computer genius. He received a very large government funding to develop an advanced machine learning algorithm and build an AI, the machine. The main goal of this AI is to process all data being fed into it from various sources, including personal information, social network, traffic data, business info, banking transaction, etc. Basically, the machine receives all kinds of data that the government can provide, including numbers, videos, images, and voice. Using the machine learning algorithms that Mr. Finch developed, the machine discovers unknown patterns from the data to do one thing, which is to predict a specific individual that will be involved in crime-related incidents. The prediction is not the name nor address, but the social security number, since it is unique. However, the machine does not know whether this individual is a good guy or bad guy. It only predicts that he or she will be involved in an incident. It also does not know why or what causes the incident. In order to prevent the incident from happening, Mr. Finch hired an ex-CIA operative, John Rich, the handsome man in the center. Mr. Rich's job is to fight and follow the individual and intervene to stop the bad things from happening. The takeaway from this team is that the machine does not try to explain how the incident happens, which is reactive, nor explain impact factors based on any theory. It only analyzes the big data that's given and makes the prediction. It does not know whether the individual is a victim or perpetrator. But it is never wrong. Something bad will happen involving that individual. In essence, it does not try to explain the incident, but rather predicts it. Once Mr. Rich intervenes and stops the incident, then we'll know what causes the incident. But it is an ex post facto. It is a great TV show, and if you are a fan of sci-fi thrillers, I strongly recommend watching it. Now, back to data mining. SAS Institute defines data mining as the process of finding anomalies, patterns, and correlations within large data sets to predict outcomes. Additionally, Nisbet et al. Defined data mining as the use of machine learning algorithms to find faint patterns of relationship between data elements in large, noisy, and messy data sets, which can lead to action to increase benefits in some form, such as diagnosis, profit detection, etc. Thus, what the machine in the TV show Person of Interest does is nothing more than data mining. The futuristic part of it is that this AI can do it so well with a huge amount of data it has processed to make the prediction. One of the common confusion that what differences between data mining research and other type research are. So I summarize here three major characteristics of data mining that we need to keep in mind. Keep them simple and focus on how we can separate data mining from other methods. First, data mining is a data-driven method. We use data mining to discover unknown or new patterns from large data. It is different from theory-driven research, which tends to focus on relationship hypotheses from existing theories or theoretical foundation. When you see articles with proposed hypotheses or research frameworks that are developed based on existing theories, such as technology acceptance models, TAM, or theory of planned behavior, TPB. They are theory-driven studies. In data mining, we do not have hypotheses. Second, data mining research is exploratory. That means we use data mining to explore new variables and relationships from data. On the other hand, explanatory research tends to focus on testing or confirming hypothesized relationships. That is why one question usually comes up with data mining research is, do you discover any new variables, relationship, or patterns? Of course, in order to discover new variables and relationship, we cannot limit ourselves to small data set with limited variables. Therefore, the third characteristic is that data mining requires large data. By large data, it means data set with many rows of data and many variables in different forms and structures. Since we do not know what we may find, we need large data. As in the Person of Interest TV show, the AI needs to have access to a huge amount of data. Many of them are rather sensitive to be able to make an accurate prediction. This is different from theory-driven explanatory research, which usually uses a smaller data set with limited variables. As you know, when we perform statistical analysis techniques such as ANOVA, multiple regressions, or even structured question modeling, we usually use some formula to find the minimum sample size needed to detect the relationships at a certain significance level and expected test power. In most cases, we should be fine with a sample size between 100 and 500. And our models tend to have 3 to 15 variables at most. On the other hand, in data mining research, we need to analyze data with hundreds of variables and several hundred thousand to million rows of data. Last but not least, due to the size of the data, data mining methods are not subject to strict statistical assumptions, and they can handle noisy and unstructured data. Many machine learning algorithms can perform well with missing values and outliers, since they are rule-based rather than statistic-based. Of course, we will still need to ensure the quality of the data to obtain meaningful outcomes. The phrase garbage in, garbage out still applies here. On the other hand, theory-driven studies tend to use statistical techniques with smaller sample size, which requires meeting strict statistical assumptions such as normality, non-multicollinearity, linearity, and homogeneity. Those requirements tend to create obstacles in data analysis process and limit the inclusion of variables in the model. But data mining is not without weaknesses. The most obvious weakness is a tendency to overfit the model to data, given the size of the data. In addition, some machine learning algorithms might require a lot of computer power to finish the analysis. More importantly, in data mining, the most time-consuming part is data preparation and treatment. Usually, 80% of the time in data mining projects is dedicated to data cleaning and preparations. To further clarify the purpose of data mining research, I want to show you the Federal Aviation Administration's, or FAA's, differentiation amongst reactive, proactive, and predictive research. In aviation safety research, the FAA categorizes three types of research, which are fundamentally different. The first type of research is reactive research, which focuses on examining events that have already happened. In other words, the researchers examine the parts to find the causes of specific incident or accident. This is what an agency like NTSB is doing. It is certainly an important type of research to do to mitigate the risk. The second type, safety research, is proactive research, which looks into the present. In other words, the researcher examines contributing factors from various aspects of hazardous conditions and organizational processes and see how they are related to the incident or accident. This type of research does not examine the causality, but rather the correlation between contributing factor and dependent variables. This is certainly an important type of research to understand holistic view of situation, develop strategies for risk management. There's two common types of research in aviation safety. The third type of research is predictive research, which looks into the future. In other words, the researcher analyzes a large amount of data to identify new potential safety problems in the future. By mining big data, researcher develops a prediction model that can predict an incident or accident before it happens. While the first two types of research focus on explaining why and how an incident has happened, predictive research focuses on predicting the incident before it happens so we can prevent it. This is the type of events that we see in the person of interest TV show. And data mining is a method used for predictive modeling. There are several buzzwords related to data mining and predictive modeling that we hear or read every day. They are artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. So I want to explain briefly the differences among them since they are overlapping and people tend to get confused about those terms. I will not get into the details since each of them is a field and degree by itself. First, artificial intelligence or AI. While AI is a growing trend of research, it's not a new term. The term AI was created back in the 1950s to refer to software that uses complex logic to automate any operations. AI has evolved significantly over time with the advance of computer science and robotics. But AI is not just about building robots. A more current definition of AI is it is a system that simulates human intelligence for solving problem or making decisions. AI can learn, predict, improve, and solve. Basically, AI could be an application or solution that automatically operates and acts with minimum human interference. Siri, Alexa, Google Assistant are some examples of AI solutions that make our life easier with smartphones, smart homes, and smart cars. Machine learning is a vital part of AI, and it started in the 1980s. Machine learning is an algorithm that learns patterns from data without explicit directions. So the data mining we have been talking about is using machine learning algorithms. These algorithms are developed based on the foundation of mathematics, statistics, and computer science. In the next few slides, I will describe some specific machine learning algorithms that we can use in our research. In the old time, in order to use machine learning, heavy coding was a must, since there's a lot of math involved and only some software such as MATLAB can handle the algorithm. Fortunately, in the last few years, more and more user-friendly applications have been created, so machine learning is no longer just the venue for mathematicians or computer scientists. Machine learning can be used for applied research as well. Last but not least, deep learning is a buzzword that we started hearing more often in 2018, and even though it was introduced back in 2010s. No one mentioned it then because very few people understood this concept. Now everyone talks about deep fake voice recognition, facial recognitions on smartphones, and Tesla autopilot. In essence, deep learning is a complex neural network with many hidden layers. Some popular deep learning is convolutional neural network and recurrent neural network. I will not get into the technicality of this field, but it's a branch of machine learning that starts growing very fast. The technology that Apple uses for facial recognition and camera is deep learning. It is also used in Tesla autopilot technology. And deep learning is also used in natural language processing, which is a core of smart assistants such as Siri, Alexa, Google Assistant, or IBM Watson. Deep learning is still an advanced subject, and in order to properly perform deep learning, we will need a lot of data and complex algorithms. Hence, it is hard to find software that can handle deep learning without programming and coding. Talking about big data, I want to provide some quick introduction to big data. First, what is big data? A common sense answer would be a lot of data, which is not wrong. The AI in the person of interest TV show has to collect and process a huge amount of data in different types and formats coming in from many different sources in real time. And of course, it requires supercomputer to store and process that amount of data promptly. The prediction would not be meaningful and useful if it takes days to make one prediction. SAS Institute defines big data as large volume of data, both structured and unstructured, that inundated a business on a day-to-day basis. But it's not the amount of data that's important. It's what organizations do with the data that matters. Big data can be analyzed for insight that lead to better decision and strategic business moves. Thus, big data is not only the amount of data, but also what we do with the data. Big data can be characterized by five dimensions: volume, velocity, variety, variability, and veracity. Volume refers to the amount of data. Business transaction, smart, Internet of Things device, industrial equipment, videos, social media, and more. In the past, storing it would have been a problem, but cloud computing and cheaper storage on platform like data lakes and Hadoop have eased the burden. Velocity refers to the speed of data. The growth of Internet of Things, data stream into business at an unprecedented speed and must be handled in a timely manner. RFID tags, sensors, and smart meters are driving the need to deal with these torrents of data in near real time. Variety refers to the type of data. Data comes in all types of formats, from structured numeric data in traditional databases to unstructured text document, email, video, audio, stock ticket data, and financial transactions. Variability refers to the variety of changes in data flows. In addition to the increasing velocities and varieties of data, data flows are unpredictable, changing often and vary greatly. It's challenging, but business needs to know when something is trending in social media and how to manage daily, seasonal, and event trigger peak data loads. Veracity refers to the quality of data. Because data comes from so many different sources, it is difficult to link, match, cleanse, and transform data across systems. Businesses need to connect and correlate relationships, hierarchies, and multiple data linkages. Otherwise, the data can quickly spiral out of control. Now we understand more about the complexity of big data. It's no longer just a very large data set. It is a business framework for success. So how do we implement big data? To implement big data successfully, we need to start with developing a big data strategy. What is our goal? What do we want to achieve with big data? Then we need to identify big data sources. What data are available? Where do we get the data? Do we have permission to access and use the data? What data can we use to business purposes, and what restriction do we have to follow? Once you find data sources, we'll need to access, manage, and store the data. How do we collect that huge amount of data from different sources? Where do we store them? Do we have enough infrastructure and computing power to categorize and store data? What equipment that protocols are needed to ensure the security of data? How do we access the data that are needed without delaying, lagging, and disruption? The next step is to analyze big data. What are our purposes? What data set do we analyze? What variables do we use? How do we prepare and clean the data? What analytic methods should we use? How do we interpret the results? And finally, we'll need to make data-driven decision. Given the data analysis results from the previous step, what are possible solutions? What are outcomes of various scenarios? And what is the best solution to solve business problems? I will come back to the person of interest TV show that I introduced at the beginning. The machine that can process all data, it has to save people's lives and sometimes save the world. It is certainly not an easy task. In conclusion, we live in the world that with too much data that overwhelms us. Some may say too much data have created chaos in our society, but we cannot change it. We have to move forward and make the best of it. I think if we can find patterns and orders in chaos, we'll be able to succeed. Thank you, and bye now.